hello. Good afternoon, AUP, and good afternoon, students.
Good afternoon, faculty, and old folks like me.
I think it's safe to say also that since it's the middle of the week, happy midweek.
Yes, happy midweek. Christine.
Happy midweek, Sir Leo. Happy How are you?
I'm fine. Have you been blessed by the meetings? Lately?
Words are not enough to say how much blessed I've been. How about you, sir?
Oh, I was fully blessed. It's just Wednesday. I'm fully blessed already. Let me just tell you this. In my AUP life, I started teaching in 1982, and now it's 2015. I have attended all the week of prayers, 2 times a year. Maybe I missed only when I was on study leave for 2 years. And so practically about 60 week of prayers I have attended in AUP. Okay. Not including those I have attended in high school and college. And I would like to tell you that my prayer life and devotional life was changed. Always change with this week of prayers.
Amen, Sir Arit. It's something that we must all look up to. It's 60 week of prayer and counting, di ba po?
Yes, maybe about 80.
Well, just this morning, we tackled about a very significant topic. And it was emphasized to us that indeed, discipline is never easy, right, sir?
It may depend on individuals, but for most of us, it's not easy.
But we must not lose hope and stop the statement there that discipline is not easy. For it was said that those who endure and had been trained in that discipline will find the peace of the Lord.
Doug Batchelor once said that he enjoyed it better in the military camp than in the private schools because discipline has changed him.
This afternoon, it will be a deeper topic also about discipline. And if anybody of you here is chained by what? Chained by sin.
Yes, how to break?
How to break that chain?
The chains of sin.
Or do you want to forever be chained to that sin? If you do, brethren,
we can only break that by accepting the Lord, our Savior, yes? And the week of prayer is really a week that must be full of prayer. It is said that daily, if you pray and have a devotional life, you will stay connected with Jesus. And you will never be disconnected to people, because if you connect to Jesus, then you are connected to people. You will love people, and there would be peace. And discipline would not be difficult anymore. Discipline would be easy.
And I'd like to share, it's a famous and a trademark that I've learned from a special friend. And that friend told me this specific words. He said that this is implying to every relationship, okay? So he said that God is love. In a relationship without God is their love. Am I communicating something here? Once more, God is love. In a relationship without God is their love. In a family without God is their love.
Of course, if we take Jesus to be our friend, we will be friend to our family members, to our siblings. No more of the rivalry. Because if we have Jesus at the center, when everybody come close to Jesus, we come close to one another.
This afternoon, dear brethren, we will witness how God will break our chains of sin. Once more, welcome.
Welcome to all of you. It may not be comfortable for you there, but just pray that the Holy Spirit will interpret to you everything, what the Bible says and what our speaker would share to us this afternoon. May the Lord bless you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, AUP. Are you ready to praise the Lord this afternoon? Okay, let's stand as we sing our theme song, Into God's Family.
Into God's family we now reside. Into God's family His love will abide. Looking to Jesus, our comfort and home. Waiting and watching for Christ soon return. And by His Spirit, we're heirs of God. Brothers and sisters to Jesus' love.
Into God's family. Good afternoon, everyone. Our prayer thoughts for this afternoon is about prayer and faith lay hold of God's power. It says, true faith and true prayer, how strong they are. They are as two arms by which the human suppliant lays hold upon the power of infinite love. Faith is trusting in God, believing that He loves us and knows what is for our best good. Thus, instead of our own way, it leads us to choose His way. Our lives, ourselves, are already His. His acknowledgments, His ownership, and accepts its blessing. Truth, uprightness, purity are pointed out as secrets of life success. Our prayer focus for this afternoon is about revival and reformation among members and leaders in the church. The sequence of our prayer is the praise team will lead the song, and then the congregation will be given 3 minutes. After that, the praise team will sing again, and then Ma'am Michelle Colliado will close the prayer. I now request the congregation to please kneel.
Holy Spirit of God, dwell in me and rule my life. Cast away every sin in my soul. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Heavenly Father, our Creator, Redeemer, and Friend, we commit ourselves to you at this very hour. Father, grant us the serenity of hearts and mind. Help us to accept the things we need to change, courage to change the things we can, and wisdom to know the difference. May you accept our petition of prayer and fill us with your Holy Spirit as we listen to your message. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessing and loving us. In the name of our loving Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray, amen.
Hello. Good afternoon. May I ask the congregation to pause for a while as I pray? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we acknowledge you, O Lord, as the only one who can free us from the bondage of sin. O Father, who am I to tell to your people that they need to free from their sins if I also need a Savior like you? I'm also weak, O Lord. I cannot do this without you. O Father, you know how much I desire to help these people, but then you reminded me that it is not my work. It is not my work to change them and to free them from the bondage of sin. It is your work, O Father, so why will I be afraid? O Father, please empower me and give me the double portion of your Holy Spirit. And take away all the fears and doubts and evil thoughts in my heart and in my mind. Please, Father, give me confidence, knowing that it is you who will speak through me. And it is your word that we will hear this afternoon. Not my word, Lord, not what I have prepared, but it is your word, O Lord, and that's the words that you want your people to hear. And so, Father, once again, I'd like your Holy Spirit to come to me, O Father. And may your Holy Spirit also come to the hearts of these people. And may the devils and all the evil angels go away from this hall so that your words alone will be glorified. You and you alone will be glorified, and your words alone will we hear this afternoon. Thank you, O Lord, for hearing this prayer, and thank you because I know you will speak to your children this afternoon. This I pray in the loving name of Jesus. Amen. I have here chains, and I have asked my two friends, where are they, to come up here and just try to break even one of these chains. Where are they? Kuya Jay and Joy Mark? Are they here? All right, I think they went somewhere. Can I ask two people or just volunteers? I think we need volunteers now. Can I ask two people to come here? All right, one, another one, please. All right, okay, so just try to break even one of those chains. Yes, just try to break. You can use your feet, you can use your two arms, you can use your anything. Just try. How about you? All right. It's so hard. All right. You see, breaking chains is so hard. But you know what? In the Bible, thank you so much, my dear friends. In the Bible, there was a man who was enchained with this kind of chains, yet he could free himself. And that was the man from Gadara, a man who was full of demons. Kindly open your Bible and open it in Mark 5, verse 4. Mark 5, verse 4. There was a man who was called demoniac. You know that story? All right, I'll read. Mark 5, verse 4, verse 3. Okay, let's start with verse 2. And when he had come out of boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces, neither could anyone tame him. So you see, this man from Gadara was so strong, he could actually break that chain, that kind of chain. But then he was full of demoniac. He was full of demons, evil spirits. And only Jesus, when he came to him, only him freed him from that bondage of sin. And so this afternoon, what we're going to talk about is, the title of my message is Break Free. What does it mean when you say break free? You break something to be free. It is an idiomatic expression which means escape from, withdraw from. Oh. All right. An idiomatic expression which means escape from, withdraw from, extricate yourself of, disentangle yourself from. So, you see, all of us here needs to disentangle ourselves from something. It is not just the kind of chain like this that can actually easily be broken, but I cannot break it. It can actually easily be broken, but there is actually a kind of chain that is so hard to break if it's only by our own self, by our own strength. It's only God who can break that kind of chain. Let's go to the story of David. You know David. I'm sure you all do. You all know him. So you see, first of all, we're going to talk about some of David's weaknesses. And these weaknesses are the sins that he needs to break free from. He needs to break it so that he could be free. First is pride. Before I thought, whenever I read the story of Solomon, I thought that he's just a good boy, a very humble man. But yes, that's true. When he was youth, when he was in his young age, in his early age, he's so humble. He's praying to the Lord. But in some point of his life, he became proud. In what point of David's life did he become proud? You remember the time when he asked his servants, count all the Israelites, count all the people who can join in my military. It's actually pride. Ellen White expressed this word, worldly success and honor, so weakened the character of David that he was repeatedly overcome by the tempter. And David determined to increase his army by requiring military service from all who were of proper age. So at some point of his life, he did become proud. And next, custom. You know what? David is a person who strictly obeys what God says. But then again, in some point of his life, he tried to follow what the world says to do, what the world practices. And in what instances of David's life did he follow the custom? When he also married more than one wife. The original plan of God for woman and for marriage is for one man to one woman only. But then, what does it say here? David afterward married Abigail. He was already the husband of one wife, but the custom of the nations of his time had perverted his judgment and influenced his actions. Even great and good men have erred in following the practices of the world. The bitter results of marrying many wives was sorely felt throughout all the life of David. So in some point of his life, it became his weakness. He followed what the world say. He go on with the custom. Next is women. We all know too that it is one of his weaknesses in some point of his life One day, when he saw a woman bathing, and she is so beautiful, she was tempted to get that woman, even though that woman was already the wife of a man, of Uriah. So, you see, David is not a perfect man. He too is a human being. He too is inclined to sin, yet he too needs a savior. So how did God deliver this man from that bondage of sin? How was he able to break free that chain of sin that entangled him? Let's see and take a look with these four important things. Take note. These four important things that God wants us to do, and this is actually a ladder progressive journey, meaning to say you have to do this first, and then this thing, and then third, and then fourth. So take note with these four important things that you need to remember to break free from the bondage of sin. Are you ready? Amen? Are you there? All right, do you want to break free from the bondage of sin? All right, before we go on with how David was able to free from that bondage of sin, let us sing He's Able. He's able, He's able, I know He is able, I know my Lord, He is able to carry me through. Closes the blind to see. Oh yes, He's able, He's able. I know He's able. I know my Lord, He's able to carry me through. Amen. God is able, and we will see how God works in the how God worked in the life of David, how he delivered this man from the bondage of sin. So, how did God deliver and save David? Four steps. First, kindly open your Bibles with you or just read from the screen. Second Chronicles 7:14. Please let us read it all together. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. You see, we have all sinned. And so this message is not just, we are going to talk about this message not just because we're going to study about the life of David. We're going to talk about these things because we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We have come fall short in the glory of God. We have sinned, and so we need a Savior. And so we need to take these four steps on how we can disentangle ourselves from the bondage of sin. So here are the four steps. You know, a while ago you have read the text, humble yourself, pray, seek God, and turn from your wicked ways. Number one, humble yourself. What does it mean by, what does it mean to humble yourself before God? And how did David do this first step? How did he humble himself? You see, when he was rebuked by a prophet named Nathan, instead of becoming angry with his rebuke, hey, who are you to say that to me? Who are you to tell me that I am a sinner? Why are you not a sinner? Instead of saying like that, he said, I have sinned against the Lord. I have sinned against the Lord. He was humbled. He realized his condition. He realized that he is wicked and he is sinful. And so first step, my dear friends, a person who humbles himself submits to admonition and rebuke. He is not proud by saying, hey you, who are you to say that to me? Who are you to correct me? Who are you to tell me that I'm wrong? I know what I'm doing. No, he did not say that. He said, I have sinned against the Lord. Oh, my dear friends, how about you? When you are being corrected by a teacher, by a father or a mother, oh, my dear son, my dear child, my dear daughter, please don't do this thing. Please, please, stop doing your wrongdoings. Stop doing that wicked thing. Are you angry? Hey, you, why? Are you perfect? Why are you telling this to me? David did not say that. He humbled himself. Next thing that he do, he prayed. You see, my dear friend, when you are humbled and you realize your condition, you realize that you are so weak and that you cannot do anything. You cannot do anything to regain your own self because you are so wicked and sinful. You will really pray because you realize that there is something up there who can break you free, or who can make you free from the bondage of sin. You prayed because you acknowledge that there is a God who is stronger, who is bigger than your sins. And that's what David did. He prayed. You see, we do not run away from God when we sin. Oh, no, no, no. I don't want to go to God because I am a sinner. I know I'm unclean. I will fix myself first before I come to Him. No, the moment David realized his sinfulness, he said, I have sinned against the Lord. And then he ran to the Lord. Oh, Lord, please, please, help me. What is his prayer? David prayed. David said in Psalm 55, verse 17, evening and morning and at noon I will pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice. He believed that there is a God who can hear him every time he kneels down, every time he prayed. There is a God who will hear him. And so, after he sinned, he did not run away from God because he's so unclean, but he ran to God because he knows that he's the only one who can cleanse him from sin. Next is seek God's face. Wow. Will you seek God's face if you actually are not interested? Are you going to seek something that you are not looking for? Of course not. You will seek for something because you desire that something to have it. And so seek God's face. It's so clear. Many people come to the Lord to seek something. Oh, Lord, I come to you and I want a house. I want a car. I want a laptop, a watch, or something that I really desire, a dress or anything, a boyfriend, a girlfriend. So many people come to Jesus just to ask something, seeking something that could benefit them. Many people forget that the reason why we come to God is not to seek something from God, but because we come to Him because we are seeking Him. That is what it says. We come to God because we seek Him. So in Psalm 27, verse 8, it says, when thou said, seek my face, my heart said unto thee, my face, Lord, will I seek. So meaning to say, it is David's desire to really seek God. And next step, turn from your wicked ways. Many people do not understand this text. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And they say, what? I can't do that. It's so hard to work out my own salvation. But my dear brothers and sisters, it doesn't end there. There is a continuation of the verse, and many people forget to this following verse. It says here, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So what does it mean by turn from your wicked ways? Many people are saying that, oh, I cannot turn from my wicked ways. It's so hard. I cannot just leave my sins and I can't do this. It's so hard to be good. It's so hard to become pleasing to God's sight. But then there is a promise. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And so that's what David did. Those four steps are key to success of breaking the chain of sin. And by the way, do not remember the prayer of David. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. He cannot do all these things if it is not God working in him. It is still the Lord working in him. That's why he was able to have that desire to humble himself, to pray, to seek the Lord, and to turn from his wicked ways. Now let's go to the story of Solomon. Okay, we still have time. Let's go to the story of Solomon. Imagine this is David and this is Solomon. And this is Bathsheba and Tamar. Okay, so we're just going to talk about David and Solomon. I was surprised as I studied the lives of these two men that they have almost the same experiences. They have a lot of similarities, even from the time they are young to the time they become kings to the time they repented. There are a lot of similarities about them. And if you will have a deeper study with the lives of these two men, you'll be surprised how they are really similar and how God really worked in their lives. So let's go with Solomon's weaknesses. First, pride. In some point of David's life, he also became proud. Yes, in his early years, he's okay. He's following the Lord. He's praying hard. He's so humble. Yet, in some point of Solomon's life, he became proud. What did Ellen White say about him? Solomon flattered himself with his wisdom and the power of his example. And he thought that he could carry out his plan. What does it say here? He thought that he could lead his wives from idolatry to the worship of the true God. And also that alliances thus formed would draw the nations round about into close touch with Israel. So he thought that, okay, fine, I am wise, I am rich, I have money, I can do this, I can think this, I can plan this, I can organize this. Then I think I can do what God wants me to do by my own self. So in some point of his life, he became proud. Next thing is custom. In some point of Solomon's life, he also did follow the custom. So gradual was Solomon's apostasy that before he was aware of it, he had wandered far from God. Almost imperceptibly, he began to trust less and less in divine guidance and blessing, and to put confidence in his own strength. Little by little, he withheld from God that unswerving obedience which was to make Israel a peculiar people, and he conformed more and more closely to the customs of the surrounding nations. So meaning to say, in some point of Solomon's life, he really followed the custom of the world. How many of us here also thought that it's okay to follow what the world does? And it's clear here, little by little, he withheld from God that unswerving obedience which he had to make Israel a peculiar people. He was deceived by the devil. He followed the custom of the world. And last is also, of course, we all know, women. Or unwholesome marriage. You know how many are the wives of Solomon, right? How many? 700. How many are the concubines of Solomon? 300. 1,000? How many are the girls here? Imagine all these girls are the wives of Solomon? Terrible. That's true. Okay, just imagine. Don't. Yeah. That's Solomon. He has this problem with women. He loves beautiful women. When she sees you, she will like you. And when she likes you, you will be his wife. And it says here, but King Solomon loved many foreign women, as well as the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites, from the nations of the Lord whom the Lord had said to the Israel of Israel, you shall not intermarry with them. So he disobeyed God. And so we can see that these three things, or these three weaknesses, are also in Solomon. How come it's so similar with his father David? As I was studying this, I'm really thinking, and I said, is it in the genes? Of course, maybe it's not in the genes. Why? I don't know. I really don't know. And then I realized as I studied deeper about this, it was really the influence of Solomon. He saw how their family became so distracted. And somehow, he saw these weaknesses of his father, and he also inherited, or he was influenced by some of David's weaknesses. By the way, before we go on with how did God deliver Solomon from this bondage of sin, let me ask you, what are other weaknesses in our generation today? Can children inherit from parents aside from pride, custom, and unwholesome marriage? You see, sometimes a person will just ask someone, who's your father? How come you're doing that things? And then only to find out that his father is also doing the same thing. We are not putting a blame here with our fathers, but somehow children, or apparently children, are influenced by the practices, by the lifestyle, or the character traits of their fathers, or even their mothers. But in here, we are studying about David and Solomon. He inherited, or he was influenced by some of David's weaknesses. So what are other examples? It could be lifestyle, like drinking alcohol, smoking cigarettes, or it could be practices like premarital sex, unwanted marriage, divorce, watching nonsense movies, or dancing, listening to music that pollutes the mind, eating unhealthy foods, and character traits like pride, jealousy, envy, selfishness. Have you tried to assess yourself? Who am I? Or what are my character traits? And where are these character traits came from? Why am I like this? Oh, my dear friends, we are not putting a blame here, but it is really important to know that parents or fathers have influenced to their children. And so, we must all be careful. We must all be careful because someday we will also become parents. Or if not parents, if you're planning not to become a parent, wherever you may be, you will have that influence. So let us be careful with what kind of influence we will show to others, and especially to parents, what kind of influence you will show to your children, and even to us as youth, what kind of influence will we show to our children when we become parents as well. So now let's go to how did Solomon overcome these sins? How did God deliver him from all this wickedness or for his sinfulness? I was again surprised to know that Solomon was also corrected by a prophet. Like David, there was a man of God, a prophet, who told him his wickedness. And so let's open our Bibles with, Ecclesiastes 1 verse 4. Ecclesiastes 1 verse 4. It says here, one generation passes away and another generation comes, but the earth abides forever. 5, the sun also rises and the sun goes down and hastens in the place where it arose. And then let's go to Ecclesiastes. Okay. Ecclesiastes 2:12 verse 1. Ecclesiastes 12 verse 1. It says here, remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days have come. And you see, if you will study the whole book of Ecclesiastes, he realized how life became so, he told that his all the things that is in here, in earth, is all vanity. Let's read Ecclesiastes 2 verse 11. Then I looked on all the works that my hands had done and on the labor in which I had toiled, and indeed all was vanity and grasping of the wind. There was no profit under the sun. Yes, in his youth he was humbled, but then when he became proud, he experienced everything that he could ever experience. He married a lot of women. He built a lot of houses. He gathered golds and silvers and treasuries. And he had all this wealth. And whatever his heart desires, he did it. He did not keep anything from him. And still, he said, all is vanity. When he was rebuked by the prophet, he realized his wickedness. And if you read the life of Solomon from Ellen White's writing, it was clear there that Solomon realized his sinfulness, and he too learned how to humble himself, to pray, to seek God, and turn from his wicked ways. That's why, let's go again to Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1. He says, remember now your Creator in the days of your youth, before the difficult days come and the years draw near when you say, I have no pleasure in them. My dear friends, you see, the Lord loves his people so much. Why did he correct David when he sinned against the Lord by a prophet? And why did he correct Solomon when he did sins against the Lord? By the way, the verse that we have just read a while ago, remember? Wait. Second Chronicles 7, verse 14, 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14, it says there, if my people which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear them and forgive them and will heal them. Do you know that this verse was spoken directly to Solomon by God in a vision? The second time God appeared to Solomon, this was his message to Solomon. Oh, my dear child. Okay. Let's go back to that verse. Okay. All right. It's anyway, open your Bibles with me in the book of 2 Chronicles 7:14. Just try to remember what God said. What God said to Solomon: "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and I will heal their land." God is so sweet. You know that? God is so, so sweet. I heard from one of the sermons of Dwight Nelson, if you know him. He said, the reason why God is saying, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, the reason why he's saying, if, is because he's giving us option. He is not trying to force us, hey you, humble yourself, pray to me, seek me, and turn from your wicked ways so that you will have a wonderful life. No, he's giving us option. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land. We have an option. We have an option to follow God, to do all these four things, or to do our own ways. Yet, remember, there are always consequences with every decisions or choices that we will make. Now, my dear friends, I'd like to ask you, what are the sins that you want to break free from? What are the sins that entangles you, or the sins that entangle you, that bind you? The sins that you thought is all right. Sins that you've probably held with you, not even thinking, not even thought, knowing that those sins are already binding you. My dear friends, the chain of sins that are in our lives can easily be broken if we have Jesus. You remember the prayer of David? Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. First of all, we have to remember that we have to offer our hearts to God before He can do something great to us. We have to offer ourselves to Him. Lord, I cannot do anything with my life. I cannot make my life beautiful. I cannot take away, I cannot break free from all this chain of sins that entangle me. But Father, I am willing to submit my life to You. I'm willing to give my heart to You. My dear friends, let us read this quotation from Ellen White. 1, 2, 3, go. The converted student has broken the chain which bound him to the service of sin and has placed him in right relation to God. His name is enrolled in the Lamb's Book of Life. My dear friends, you know what? I want to share a testimony with you. While I was preparing this sermon, I was really afraid. I'm telling God, are you sure, God? Are you calling me? And this is what I'm going to preach? When I studied the life of David and Solomon and learned from their stories and their experiences, that they were really entangled, they are really binded by the sins. I thought, how can I change the people? How can I tell them to break free from the sins that entangle them? How can I tell them with power, with conviction, and how will they be able to know that this message is so important? Take note, this message comes from the Word of God. It is really God who said this to Solomon. If my people, and God is considering all of us here as His people, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, and I'm telling to God, Lord, I don't have the power. But then I prepared a lot, I studied, I read the lives of Solomon and David. And as I was doing this, I want to appear good in preaching. And then I was really trying to make my sermon beautiful. Only to find out, at the last minute, God is telling me, my dear child, you are too proud. You want to appear there beautiful and good. You're too proud. In your heart, there is sin within you. I'm not pleased with that kind of character that you have, with that kind of feeling that you have to appear so good in front of your people. By the way, my dear child, this is not your message. This is my message. And so if ever you are not able to deliver the message with how you thought it to happen, with how you imagined it, don't worry, my dear child. I will be the one to explain to them this verse. And even though after this message, maybe you will feel like, I need to hear more. It's lacking. I need to hear more explanation. Oh, my dear child, oh, my dear friends, God is telling me, do not worry. I will be the one to explain them. After the week of prayer, as they go out from the hall, I will talk to each of them. I will convict them in their rooms. I will tell them, oh, my dear child, I love you so much. Remember the sermon that you've heard in the church a while ago? I want you to come to me. I want you, my dear child, to pray. I want you, my dear child, to humble yourself. I want you, my dear child, to seek me. Do not just seek things from me, but please, my dear child, seek me. And I want you, my dear child, to turn away from your wicked ways. Yes, you might have character traits that you have inherited from your ancestors, from your fathers, from Adam and Eve up to the time the generation passes up to this time. Yes, you have those kind of sins. And maybe the things that we have just mentioned are just few things. Pride, custom, following the custom and woman. And those examples that I have mentioned a while ago are just few of the examples that you're seeing that are the sins of the world in our generation. Yet, God is able. God is able to make us free, to disentangle all the sins that bind us, that entangles us. And so, my dear friends, let me ask you, and may I ask my friend here to come now, and while I'm doing this to have an appeal, you can now play piano. Have you tried to assess yourself? Have you tried to pause for a while, sit down, or as you lie down in your bed, you have thought about your life, how you are doing? Have you tried to think, what are the sins that are binding you, that are entangling you? What are the sins that you want to break free? Have you tried to assess that, my dear friends? Do you want to break free from different kinds of sins that are polluting or that are killing our world right now? What are the sins that are polluting or are killing our world right now? Do you want to break free from watching pornography? Do you want to break free from listening to bad music that pollutes the mind whenever you're alone? Do you want to break free from eating unhealthy foods that are killing you little by little? Do you want to break free from wearing sensual clothes that attract people? Wearing sensual clothes. Do you want to break free from smoking cigarette? I don't know if there are some of you here experience smoking cigarettes. I don't know. Do you want to break free from drinking alcohol? Do you want to break free? Do you want to break free from thinking evil thoughts? Oh, my dear friends, I tell you, thinking evil thoughts could kill a person. Many people, just by thinking and thinking and thinking how the world is going, they become so distressed. And because of these evil thoughts, they even decide to kill themselves, to have suicide because they cannot face the world anymore. Do you want to break free from thinking evil thoughts, negative thoughts? Do you want to break free, my dear friends, from any kind of sin that entangles you? My dear friends, this sermon is not enough to change you. This sermon is not enough to convict you of your sins. This is not enough, my dear friends. This sermon is not enough to open your or to change your heart. This is not enough. There is no power if the Holy Spirit will not be in you. So ask the Lord. It's actually the work of God. It's actually the work of God. You know that? The reason why He's asking us to humble ourselves before Him, the reason why He's asking us to pray and seek Him and turn from your wicked ways is because He is the one who will do all this. All we need to do is to come to Him, humble ourselves before Him and tell Him, Lord, what can I do? I am so sinful. I've tried and tried and tried my best. Oh, Father, I tell you, there was a time in my life when there are these evil thoughts that really run through my mind. I always think of these evil thoughts, crazy thoughts, negative thoughts, doubts, fear, dirty, ugly, and it's like killing me. And I will even wake up in the morning and cry to the Lord, Lord, why is this thought in my mind? I don't want to think this. No one knew that. I'm just the only one who knew that. And then I didn't even share that to anyone. No one knew that except God. And then I said to Him, Lord, I've tried. I've read books how to not to think of these things. I've tried to meditate. I'd go to places where I can be alone. And I tried to read books and tried to watch wonderful movies. I tried to sing songs. I tried and tried my best. I really write in my diary, okay, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I'm going to do. I will never think of this thought anymore. It's so polluting my mind. It's so crazy and ugly and dirty. And I don't want to think of this. And I don't know how to do that. Even in the middle of the night, I will wake up and no one knew that. My parents are sleeping, my sisters are sleeping, and I will really cry to the Lord and tell Him, Lord, I don't want to think of this anymore. It's so dirty. It's so ugly and crazy. It's just evil thought. I'm not smoking. I'm not drinking alcohol. I haven't experienced premarital sex. I don't have this kind of testimony where I can say, oh, before I'm like this, and now I'm like this. I don't have. But no one knew what is running in my mind, that it's polluting me and it's killing me. And it's like I'm in the bondage of sin and I want to make myself free, but I can't. But it's the moment I come to the Lord and said, oh, Father, You know, I can't do this. I've tried everything I can to stop me from thinking this. I tried everything I can to remove these evil thoughts in my mind. But Father, I can't do this. Now I know I can't do this. I humbled myself to Him. I prayed and told God, I cannot do anything about this anymore. I can't remove these ugly thoughts in my mind. I can't. And then it's the time I realized I need to seek the Lord. It's not just the things that God can give me. It's not just forgiveness that I must seek. It's not just things that I'm looking for, but it's really the face of God that I need to see. And so I said, oh Lord, it is only by seeking you I can see your glory. It's only by beholding you I can be changed. And so over and over again, over and over, it's not just a one-time experience that you will humble yourself and pray and seek God's face and turn from your wicked ways. It's a process. Every day the devil is tempting us. We are living in a generation full of sin. We are in a great controversy. When I studied the great controversy and read how Satan works in the lives of women, I realized how these thoughts are in my minds. That's why the devil is so strong. He's trying to pollute my mind. But when I realized that I need the Lord, it's the time. The Lord revealed to me that He's the only one who can break me free from the chain of sin. And instead of thinking of these ugly and crazy and negative thoughts and doubts and these things that are in my mind, I would continually pray and pray and pray. And my dear friends, it's a wonderful thing to pray. You know that? Even when you are walking, this is week of prayer, by the way, and I want to emphasize the importance of continually coming to God in prayer, in seeking His face and in humbling yourself before Him. There is this power in prayer. Even while you are walking, even while you are lying in your bed, even while you're talking to your friends, connect your mind to Jesus. Pray. Whisper a prayer to Him so you can be safe from the wiles of the devil. And so let me ask my friend here to sing a song. And I pray that as she sings this song, you will bow your head and you will think of the things that are entangling you. I cannot pinpoint or I cannot tell you everything or every sin that binds you. But my dear friend, as she sings this song, be the one to think in your own self. I might not be able to say every sin that could bind us, but my dear friend, I pray, pause for a while as she sings. Think, ask the Holy Spirit to open your mind and tell Him, Lord, what are the sins that entangling me? Is it also bad thoughts? Is it also bad habits? Is it also bad practices? Is it also character traits? Oh Father, be the one to let me know what are the things that are entangling me.
the family of God. In the family, the
dear friends, there is a promise in John 8, verse 36. First, let's read in or John 7, verse 32. John 8:32. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We are Abraham's descendants and have never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say, you will be made free? Jesus answered them, Most assuredly, I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave to sin, and a slave does not abide in my house forever, but a son abides forever. Therefore, if the son makes you free, you will be made free indeed. My dear friends, the Son of Man, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, will set us free. And let us pray continually that the Holy Spirit will continually talk to us. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much. For the message that you've given to us. It might not be perfectly delivered, O God, but I'm sure it's not my work to convict your people. It's not my work to transform them. It's not my work to invite them to break free from the chain of sin. It's not my work, O Father, to change their hearts. It's your work. The message is simple, Father. It's from your own word. It's you who said that to us. You said, Oh Father, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. Oh, Father, how many of us here have been entangled with sin many years already? I do not know. I cannot say that. I do not know their hearts. I do not know their minds, Father. But you can read our hearts. You know all the people who are in here. You know the people who are in bondage of sin. You know how we tried and tried and tried and tried our best to make ourselves free from those sin, O Father. But right now, right here, you said, Oh, my dear child, all you have to do is to come to me. Give me your heart, and I'll be the one to change you. Humble yourself. Pray to me. Seek my face. Turn from your wicked ways. It is me who will work in your life. Oh, Father, what a wonderful word it is to say to your children, to humble ourselves and to pray and seek your face, Father. Here are your children. Please, Father, accept us. The message is so clear, oh, Father. Be the one to convict us. Be the one to transform us. And be the one to break free, to break away the chains of sins that are entangling us. Be the one to take away all those sins, O Father, and let us glorify you forever. And there is a reward, O Father. We will see you and we will be with you forever in that heavenly kingdom. O Father, thank you so much for this message that you've given to your children. All these things we ask and pray in the loving name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Choir, we will be having a practice here at the the left side of PIC. Please come right away.